This episode of the Jesse T Show is brought to you by 46andTwo Wealth Partners. This year, many people have lots of money questions. Finding the right information can be tough, and more importantly, finding someone that you like and have confidence in is even tougher. If you'd like to keep more of your money, and more importantly, if you'd like to stop trading time for money and live the life you deserve, contact 46andTwo Wealth Partners today. Right now, Jesse T Show listeners will receive a free 15-minute phone call that will leave you with at least one idea on how to keep or make more money. Text promo code Jesse T Show to phone number 202-301-4503.
Maurice, welcome to the Jesse T Show, brother.
Thank you, Jesse. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's my pleasure, man. I've been excited to have this conversation for a while. I know you're a busy man from moving from New York to Germany, and now we finally get you.
I know, right? I know, right? Yeah.
Yeah, man. So thanks so much. You know, we want to talk about a lot of things today. You've had a great life story, you know, a lot of interesting things that you've done, from military service to being a founder and a business owner and helping people scale their businesses and doing a lot of cool things there. So if you want to give the folks, the listeners, a little bit of context on who you are, maybe some overview of what you've done in your career, and we'll go from there.
Absolutely. My name is Maurice, as you heard at the beginning. I work actually for two companies. The one is Open Exchange, where I'm the head of customer success and business intelligence. And then the second one, and I think that's the more important one for our conversation here, that is, I started a New York Marketing Academy, which is really dedicated to for SMBs and small companies, for them to learn more about doing the business and new marketing and so on. And yeah. In essence, that's what I do.
Unbelievable. So you are originally from Germany, correct?
I'm originally from Germany. That's correct. Yeah.
And
moved to the US like 10, almost 11 years ago.
And did you go from Germany straight to New York? Is that where you landed?
Yeah, absolutely. Very boring. We went to West New York, New Jersey, stayed there for 10 years, and now we moved back to Cologne, Germany. Yeah.
What was the pull to New York of all places that you could go in the United States?
It's New York.
Just because it's New York, the biggest city, right?
It's New York, right? And the other thing is just the jobs. My wife got an offer that we simply couldn't decline. And back then I had a company called Energy Patents that was busy with alternative energies and so on. That didn't work that well for us. But still, New York is a great place to be.
And now I think this is September 28th when we're recording this, 2020.
Yes.
And you said that you just moved about a month ago, somewhere around August, give or take.
Yeah, exactly.
What was the landscape like in New York with the coronavirus up there? Were you seeing a lot of businesses that were shut down and I've seen a lot of pop-up stuff in front of restaurants, like on the street? Like talk to us a little bit about the scene and setting up there in New York.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the initial month, as you can imagine, New York was hard hit, right? The entire New York metro was hard hit. So you saw complete standstill. There was nothing happening at all on the streets. But then come June, you saw that, especially the small businesses, like the small corner cafe and whatever, right? They started to be a bit more creative in what they could do. And then our favorite place, we were like, hey, what about, you know, you offer it to all to go and do a lot of things. So yeah, that's what you've seen there. And we went out, my wife and I went out to those small businesses that we liked and ordered our cafe and paninis and ate them in front of the store in the car. And, you know, but that's what you saw. You saw a lot of people putting it, the entire business outside, really on the streets, right? And as long as the weather was good, that worked. Now with fall approaching and maybe winter approaching in a few months, I'm curious to see how that's gonna work. Right.
But did you notice, I've seen some people that I follow on social media that live in New York City and they do business in New York City. Did you see a dramatic shift in just how the city was operating in terms of how many people were on the streets? And was there a mass exodus of people that actually like left because New York changed completely? Like they either moved or temporarily moved, or did you see any of that?
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, I live on the New Jersey side of the area. And what we saw when we tried to get rid of our apartment, there were almost all of the people that came by were ex-Manhattanians, and they tried to move out of the city because with all this working from home, right, they were open to move somewhere else to get a bit more bang from the buck. So that's what we saw, right? People moved and left the city because initially that was shocking and everybody was really scared of, okay, what's going to happen here? How am I going to keep myself safe? And if you're in a small Manhattan apartment, that's a bit more a challenge, right?
Yeah, I have a good friend up there now, and they're trying to move down here. And basically, just what they can get for the money where they are in the city is next to nothing in terms of size. And the whole reason for being there for a lot of people is either the economy or the lifestyle. And both have completely changed, right? So like whether it's business or whether it's being able to, the city that never sleeps and being able to go do a bunch of stuff, like a lot. And so now the attraction for a lot of people, like you said, for people that are working from home or for people that, you know, they're realizing they don't want to necessarily be in the city the whole time. So they are moving. So that's interesting. So for you, you did move and you went back to, was this because of Corona that you moved, or was this something that was always planned to go back to Germany?
There were like 100 reasons for it, okay. why we had to move back to Germany. Some of it was choice. The time wasn't our choice, but that we wanted to go back, that was choice because our family is all in Germany and our parents are getting a bit older and you want to be close. So I should see that happening, right?
Yeah, you want to be close to family. So for you, how was the transition actually picking up and moving during a pandemic to a whole back to another country?
A bit more interesting than we would have liked to. The good thing is we had corporate support from my wife's company. They helped us quite a bit, but everything from just the registration here in Germany where you cannot meet anybody in person, and then everything just takes longer, right? Because you need to have an appointment, and all those steps take so much longer than before. Before it would be like a 2-day operation and you're done. Annoying as it would be, but still 2 days, right? It's not that bad. And now it took like weeks.
Wow. So you're kind of touching on a little bit of what's happening in Germany. And I have no clue, right? Yeah, I only know what's going on in my backyard here in Georgia and some places around the United States I hear about, but I don't live there. So now that you're living back in Germany, what are some of the things that you're seeing in terms of how locked down is it in terms of Corona? Is it not even an issue over there? Like, what does it look like over there?
Yeah, it's not really an issue anymore. I think Germany right now, the numbers are comparable to the ones that we have in New Jersey.
Okay.
And that at a population that is like 10, 11 times as much than New Jersey, that's quite impressive, right? We got here, we got out of the plane, we were wearing masks on the street, and people looked at us funny, like, guys, that's like so 5 months ago.
Take them off, yep.
We don't do that anymore, right? You wear them if you go into a store and these kind of things, but yeah, it's okay. You can, on the street, you can just walk around, right?
Beautiful. Yeah, that's how it is in Georgia too. If you're out and about doing your own thing, you'll see some people wearing masks, but for the most part, they're not. But like as soon as you go into a store, a lot of people are wearing them just to kind of, you know, even if it's for other people, making other people feel better and, you know, protecting other people. So as far as like, I see some things in the background, obviously you just moved and so you have some stuff everywhere, but I'm looking, you know, we kind of chatted about this a little bit with the medals. And for me, it's over those medals. Talk to us about those. What are those for?
Well, I actually started my marketing in the German army. I was part of psychological operations, which is in many ways, it's just marketing for the army, right? It's just that your campaign is stop shooting, right? And please assemble here and start the voting process. And that's what I did in Bosnia back in 96 and in 97 when I was much younger. that's where
just a few years ago.
just a few years ago. Yeah, that's where I learned my marketing chops and the research and customer empathy, right? All of that.
So PSYOPs, I've never really known, much about it. And for you to say that it's more like marketing and kind of like steering people to do something or not do something, in my mind, it was more like, and maybe it is in different aspects, but I'm thinking more like fear and maybe even like, I guess the extreme way to do this would be like gassing people like Saddam Hussein did back in the day.
That's more than PSYOPs. That's actually doing stuff, right?
Yeah. Okay.
PSYOPs, so you're talking about stuff and you're showing stuff.
So with PSYOPs in general, is it pretty much what you did, or are there different avenues within PSYOPs that different, you know, operations can take?
Well, there's different levels of it, right? The one is you operate with the truth. The second is I still operate with the truth, but you kind of keep things for yourself. And the third level is, it's called black PSYOPs, where you just lie, right?
Just lie.
That's not popular because once that happens, everything else that you try to do is kind of done, right? Nobody, you lose your entire authenticity and people won't react to that well.
So that's, overall, that's last case scenario for most things.
Oh yeah. When that's when that's all that you got left, maybe you do that. But in many different armies, it's actually forbidden to do that, right? For example, in the German army, black psyops was forbidden. I think the U.S., in theory, can do it, but it's a tough thing to do.
So PSYOPs, it sounds like it actually is a pretty well-intentioned thing, right? Like, is that fair to say, or is there not good intentions in all PSYOPs?
Well, if you're in marketing, you can say it's well-intentioned. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what you want to achieve is you want to inform people, and you use information and details so that they better do what you want them to do, right? The easiest one is stop shooting, right? Because you tell them, hey, we got all this weapon around you and you're everywhere. There's nowhere for you to go. Why don't you stop shooting, right? And it's a good thing. And
changing behavior.
Change your behavior, right? Yeah. Yep. Instead of going left, go right and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Looking at the U.S. campaign over the last almost 20 years, you know, Operation Iraqi Freedom and Operation Iraqi Freedom 2 and all Enduring Freedom and all that stuff, was there anything to you being in that business, so to speak, years ago that stood out glaringly to you? Like, that's a PSYOP. Like, were you able to pick up on some of the campaigns? And like, if you were, what stood out to you?
I mean, PSYOPs in many ways, every press conference, it has PSYOP content. Every news article that you see has PSYOP content, right? I don't know really from those operations in recent years, but I know in the first Gulf War, that they threw off radios to make sure that people could get their messages, right? And they would then transmit music on one hand, but also information like, hey, people, you can get food here. And this is why this is all happening. It's not our fault, right? There's this guy, Saddam Hussein, and he's a bad guy and so on, right? These are our intentions. So it's really about spreading information so that people get it from the horse's mouth instead of hearing it from the opposition, right?
What's the most interesting thing that you've experienced or the craziest thing you've experienced during that time when you were doing that?
Well, I was in Bosnia. I was in the Serbian area, and the Serbs back then, they didn't want to play ball, as we all know, right? So we were handing out a magazine, and the headline of the magazine was, this is why the other groups get that much more money, and you better behave. And that didn't go over that well. So a lot of times people lit that magazine on fire and threw it after us and so on. So that really changed my threshold when it came to bad feedback in marketing. Because once I've never seen that when I did promotions for Reebok, for example, or for Nike and other brands, that people would throw stuff at me. That never happened. Or like my flyer on fire and anything like that, right?
Throw
that
it back at
doesn't
you.
Doesn't happen. That usually doesn't happen, right?
That, you still decided to make marketing your career. So you went. Did you go directly into how long were you actually in the German army for?
Just over 3 years.
Okay.
And in the last year, I actually started founding a marketing agency. That's how I started that off, right?
What was the muse for that? Was it just the experience that you gained? And walk us through the inception and like what that first year or two looked like for you.
Friends of mine already had a TV production company, and they asked me if I could build up the marketing side of the house. And that's essentially what I did. Because with all the experience that we had with the PSYOP, and that is really understanding your target audience, right? We all know that segmentation and all of this. And then bringing out the right message via the right channels. And that is marketing at its core, right? That's what we do today with social media. It's really knowing what it is that you need to say and how to say it and who your audience is. And that's how I started. And then, in, what is it, 89 or so, I started an agency and was initially a street promotion agency. We did that for Def Jam and, you know, more the urban way, but then we grew up to bigger companies. I mentioned Reebok already. I mentioned Nike, but we also did Dodge, for example. We did all of the music industry, all of the movie industry, and a lot of the fashion labels, right?
Wow. So you had some really great experience. Was that pretty early on? Was that right, like in the first couple of years, or is that just through the whole time you've been doing this?
No, that was pretty much early on, because at that time in Germany, that was new. Nobody did it this way. Everybody had the same type of promoters. But what we did, we used the right promoters for the target audience. So if it was something for an older audience, we used that kind of promoter. If it was youth marketing, we used younger promoters, right? That was unique.
What was the inroads to those, the relationships? Was it the company you were working with? Like, how did you land those bigger clients? Because some of those clients you named are some of the biggest clients in the world in terms of just size of company and reach of their product and demand for their product. Like you say, Nike's, you know, a worldwide global brand. How do you make inroads and make partnerships with those companies? Was it something that you had to go do? Was there other people that were like business development type people in the office? How did you make those relationships happen?
Well, to be honest, if you have a TV show in the background, right, and you already have marketing experience and marketing relationships with a lot of companies because you show their product on TV and you do a lot of events and so on, that really was the door opener. But from then on, we had to establish our brand of marketing, which we call brand experience marketing, to say, hey, listen, guys, you need to do things differently, right? Because we did research with them, and we did for Reebok, for example, we analyzed their positioning in the stores, and that new brand, RBK, was the brand with Allen Iverson at the front of it, right? He was the testimonial, and then people said, like, what is this about? We got the packages, but nobody knows what it is, and it's back there in the corner, right? Right next to the gym shoes from aerobics, right? And that doesn't work, right? So we were lucky. We had K-Swiss was one of our first clients, and we got amazing feedback for them and amazing performance for them in terms of sales. And that brought Reebok to our door, and after Reebok came Nike. And you know, once you have one or two of those brands and you have a positioning in the market, it went well from there. And people switch companies and so on, right?
Yeah, you start building clout and recognition, and people want to work with you. So in your role during that whole time, what are you doing day to day? Like, what's your day look like when you're doing that, and how did that evolve kind of through the years?
Well, back then, what I would do is really two things. For one is organizing the promotion teams. We had about 2,000 promoters across Germany and Austria and Switzerland. So that takes up some of your time. And then the others was like writing concepts and proposals for companies, right? Coming up with new proposals, strategies and so on. Not all of them were successful in terms of we could sell them, but pretty proud of what we did back then.
But let's crack into a little bit of marketing in today's environment. And you touched on one of the main avenues these days, which may be the main avenue, is social media. And all the different things that are happening through social media, from Facebook ads to stuff that you can do through Instagram and, you know, influencer marketing. And there's so many things that you can do and so many avenues that for the common business person that's looking, you know, let's say you have a brand new CPA or a brand new, you know, lawyer or whatever's going on, you know, whatever kind of business they are, it could be an auto body shop. A lot of them are getting spammed left and right with like the latest, greatest new marketing technique from like Ty Lopez or Frank Kern or some of these people that are out there that have succeeded at a high level, but they do what they do. How do you focus on one thing, you know, or maybe even multiple things, but like, what would you recommend to that business owner that's looking to get into marketing and like some things they should really kind of sink their teeth into, and then how to go about learning about doing those things well?
Well, for one, there's my New York Marketing Academy, if I can bring this up here. I'm also written a book because of exactly that reason, right? It's all the marketing books that I've read before, they are all great. But the problem there is, what do you do Monday morning if you switch on the light, right? That's where those books leave you alone. And that's what I try to pick up on with my book and giving guidance. Okay, this is your first step. This is what you can do. And then really be pragmatic about it, right? Not everything takes hundreds and thousands of dollars to do. Some of it is really simple, right? You can use platforms the free agent, for example, or you use Fiverr and those kind of platforms to really get you there and get there quicker. Not everything has to be the big investment. And I think that's the most important first step, is be calm, take it easy, right? Take it one step at a time, see how that works for you, and then make it a bit bigger, right? There's a lot of experts out there that can help you for a small amount of money. You don't have to go with a big agency immediately, and you don't have to panic, right?
Right. So for you, in terms of kind of tried and true, I know there's so many tools that you can use and so many, you know, opportunities to do marketing.
Yeah.
I guess it comes down to, you know, one or two things. For me, I've always learned, it's like, what do I want to do and how do I want to show up? If I want to be, you know, build a social media brand, you know, focus my attention there. If I want to, you know, get out there and maybe, you know, use a podcast to reach people across, you know, countries or different places. But what are some really effective tools that you've seen in terms of the types of marketing tools that that you use and you help your clients understand and use better?
Yeah, first of all, I think exactly what you say is organize. And that might be the most German thing to say, but it's really organize your output, right? You don't have to have 47 posts on a Monday and then don't do anything on a Tuesday, for example. Organize it. Find your spots when you want to do something. Find the ways and how you want to do it, and then use tools like Hootsuite to help you post those messages, right? And plan it out for a month at a time. Because what you don't want to do is you don't want to start out great for 2 weeks and then week three you're lacking the content because you kind of used everything up in the first time, right? So come up with a plan, find storylines that you want to talk to, and storylines that keep you active for a longer time, that is longer than a week or so, right? Like you do with your podcast. You have your storylines. You know exactly what kind of people you want to have in there, and you take it from there. You do your promotion, and you're thorough, and you do it with frequency, right? People can depend on the content is coming from you every, let's say, Monday or Tuesday or Monday and a Thursday and so on. And that's a lot of what you have to do. Use the tools that are out there and start off small and learn, right?
I think, like the big thing that you're saying there that I've learned over the years in my own adventures of marketing is consistency and being, you know, top of mind. And you don't have to spam a bunch of people, you know, like on one day, like you mentioned. But what you can also do is use forever content that you can repurpose. So
exactly.
Even like with just my podcast, you know, we've been doing this for about 2 years, you know, from one episode, I can pull 5 to 10 clips, and those clips can be insightful and poignant either from the guest or from myself. And like, just, you know, if there's something on my heart that's in narrative with that storyline I want to talk about, I can just pump out a clip, or I could pump out a trailer, or just kind of a soundbite. And in one podcast episode, I can get, you know, 20 to 30 different, you know, pieces of content. And that's just one episode. And if I have almost 100 episodes, I mean, I have years worth. I have video clips that I haven't even used yet. And I don't know if I ever will. But it's good. It's good because you start building this database and you can build narratives and say, hey, you know, I want to talk about women in business, or I want to talk about overcoming this type of struggle, or, you know, whatever it might be. So are those the types of things that you're having conversations with your clients? And let me even back up further than that, is what is a good client for you in terms of who you like to work with and who you like to bring into your world, and who you can probably help the best when it comes to your platform?
Well, I think what works best for me is clients that really say, hey, I need help. And this is what I'm looking for. Right. And then even I worked with one friend of mine, for example. He was a photographer, and he said, hey, my sales funnel doesn't work. I need help. What else can I do? And then what we did is we reviewed his business and figured out that there's, like, with this photo shooting that he does, there's other things where people approach him, like what equipment does he use? How does he do his photo shooting? What kind of preparations goes in there? And so he started writing blog posts and doing social media where he just covers this, right? And it's like a byproduct of his main profession. And because he had more visibility because of it, because of the blog posts and so on, he got more photo shooting requests, right? He got more jobs in that way. And that's what you have to do. Just because you do one business, for example, I wrote a book, but coming from the book, it comes the idea of, hey, I could make this an academy, or from the pull quotes that I have in the book, that's my social media posts. I have like 300 some pull quotes, right? I can reuse this. I can use those little quotes from the book and come up with special blog posts again. That's what you said, right? Repurposing the content that you have and really being ready to rewrite and refigure out everything that you do. there's many more ways in using your main profession than just the plan A. Right?
Yeah.
There's a plan B, C, and D. At least.
Getting creative, right? And having people around you like yourself that can guide you and show them.
Exactly.
And being that guide and being that expert that you are, is there any one form of marketing? It's a two-part question. Any one form of marketing that is just completely dead that you just like would stay away from altogether? And or outside of that one form of marketing, how long do you normally stick with a new marketing campaign to see if it's actually going to work? And I'm sure because you know what to do, but like, let's say like this, you know, business owner wants to go out and do, you know, a social media marketing campaign. And, you know, let's say they're doing it right, you know, and they're doing the right things. Cause that could be a huge issue is they don't know what they're doing, but let's say they're doing it right. How long would you stick with a program before you can truly vet it out? Like, cause what I've talked about and heard from people is, you know, when it comes to habits, the whole like 21 day rule, but that's bygone. Now it's like 60 days before you can have a habit stick. And some people say 90 days, right? So how long should someone stay with, again, let's go back to the beginning, any forms of marketing that are just garbage. And then the second piece is how long should somebody stick with a form of marketing before they should ditch it or double down on it?
Well, that's a good question. For the first part, well, marketing that's garbage, get rid of it immediately, right? Yep. Especially if you're in a digital environment, you see that it's not working almost immediately, right? It's give it a day or two, but by then the latest, you see that's whether it's work or it doesn't work. So that's where you need to have the measuring, the metrics and so on in place. So that's one thing. But the second part of the question is really, if you know your users, for example, I work a lot with companies that have email clients, right? They use email, that was email tools, and they know that the active user for them logs in once a month. So shutting down your promotion in within 2 weeks doesn't make sense, right? Because it doesn't match the behavior of the audience that you're addressing, right? If your audience is every 4 weeks where you know that they're going to log in once, shutting it down after 2 weeks doesn't make sense. Shutting it down after 6 weeks maybe makes more sense, right? Or modifying. But in general, what you do, there's, especially in a digital environment, it doesn't cost you a lot to do A-B testing. Don't go out with one bet, right? Try different alleys and test them against each other. Modify quickly and test this again, right? That's the iteration, the rinse and repeat kind of approach is really what is unique to these times versus what people used to do 20 years ago, because the feedback from the customer for the audience didn't get back in that quick, right? It was all very heavy and you didn't know where radio performed immediately back then. But now you can look at social media, right? You kind of create a link so that people react with you and engage with you on social media. You know it immediately how it's performing and how it's not performing, right?
Yep.
And then
yep.
Go ahead and tweak.
I love that. Right. I don't know if you know the name Dr. Alex Mayer, but he's Ty Lopez's partner. And I know them through my mentor, and I got some insight from Alex Mayer one time, and he was telling me, because he's amazing at marketing, and he was telling me, I was at like this mastermind where he was there, and he was sitting next to me and asked him a few questions. And he was basically like, he looks at it like, he calls it the rotisserie, where basically like if you, it's very scientific, because he's a NASA scientist, like he's a rocket scientist, right? So he knows what he's doing. Have you heard of this guy before?
No, I haven't.
Dr. Alex Mayer, have you heard of Ty Lopez before?
Oh, yeah.
Ty Lopez. So yeah, the guy, the brains, Ty's smart, but I guess the brains behind the operation is probably Dr. Alex Mayer. And Dr. Okay. Alex Mayer was saying, when you're doing A-B testing or when you're testing out a new marketing thing, you only want to change, it's a very scientific approach. Like you only want to change one thing every time.
Exactly.
Like if you have like 9 pieces to the puzzle, you don't want to change multiple pieces because you won't be able to truly test what's working. So I think that's kind of what in the lane of what you're talking about is you could test and reiterate and move fast. And so you touched on email marketing. You know, back in the day when email was newer, open rates were much higher than they are today. And people feel like they get spammed a lot with their email. So any tips, tricks, or insights kind of just, you know, that maybe, you know, the new person that's trying email marketing, like best practices, do's and don't do's when it comes to email marketing?
Well, first of all, it's about creating value, right? If you all you do is try to sell something, it's not going to work. But it's not just for email. It's in general, right? So what I try to do is I have a 4-to-1 rule. So 4 times value, 1 time selling, right? So people have to learn that the email that's coming from you has a value to them, right? And once that is established, they're much more open to any sales message from you, right? And then I also, what I also try to do is I try to offer value and that value to leads to them purchasing anything. For example, I give, I hand out free consulting sessions, for example, for 30 minutes and about a certain topic, for example. And then if they like it, they can still go ahead and book the for paid session. But the first session is for free and then they can make up their mind first if they like it or not. So I don't like to just talk people into submission, right? I like to I like them to come to the conclusion that they like my product and liked what I'm selling them. And then because one selling once is fine, but I'd rather sell to them 100 times, right?
Yeah.
Because that is recurring revenue. That's what we all after, recurring revenue, right?
That lifetime value of the client, you want it to perpetuate. And obviously it sounds like you're the type of person that wants to do business right so that people stay around and you build some sort of relationship with them. You know, not everyone's going to be your best friend, but if you can have people in your business that you like to a degree and they like you, it makes your business that much sweeter for sure. So, so when it comes to value, and I was a big Gary V guy for a long time. And so Gary V has a book called Jab, Jab, Jab. It might be three jabs, but Jab, 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 Right Hook. And it's exactly what's in line with what you're talking about, where it's like add value, add value, add value, add value, which is the jab. And then the right hook would be like ask for something.
Exactly.
Yeah. So can you do that? The add value, it sounds like it takes time, right? Like you can't just add value in one shot, like you, or can you, right? Like, so like what is adding value? So you have your consulting call for 30 minutes. That's one part of like your value ladder, so to speak. But when it comes to adding value, it's going to be more of a farming type thing where it takes a little bit longer.
Yeah. There's different things that I put out there. For example, again, working with a lot of small companies, I learned that some of them, what they're needing is very basic. For example, I have a couple of clients, they don't know how to manage their cash flow and to kind of predict what their sales funnel would look like, right? And how much conversion rate they're going to have. So that is a template that I have there and putting that in front of them and offer that for free. And then, yes, they can sell a course where I describe this and go in deeper. But still, the template is there. There's a blog post for it and so on. So there's a lot of, you have like a basic free offer and then you have like the premium offer that goes deeper. And then if they even need more and need me to look at their situation specifically, then they can book a session and we find ways of dealing with it, right? It's okay to make money. But if you try to get money out of each and every little step, people will feel this, right? And people will think okay, there's a hook coming. Where's the bad news, right? It's just luring around the corner. And that's not the kind of relationship you want to have. At least not, I don't want to have that with them, right?
No, you don't, no, people, I've heard this couple things about this. People don't love to be sold to, but they love to buy. If they feel like it's their decision, if they feel like they're kind of ready for it. The other piece to this was, I've been in sales one way or another my whole life. And there was this one company I was with for years. And they talked about people could see the dollar signs in your eyes. So like if you're very like pushy, aggressive, you're moving too soon on something, you know, you're trying too hard, people can kind of smell that and see that a little bit.
Yeah.
And they'll naturally back up, you know, they'll kind of keep you at arm's length. So it's interesting that it conveys in your, marketing kind of world as well.
I mean, people know that eventually you want to sell them something, right? Let's be honest. Everybody understands that part of the deal. But it's how you get them there and what kind of relationship you build. And then it's their decision and they see the value and then they pay for it, right?
Yeah, people want to buy from people they like, know, and trust is what it comes down to a degree, right?
Exactly.
And I think that's just business 101. It's how you make people feel. It's the value you can deliver. It's your word that you keep your word. Showing up the right way in each interaction. So now we've talked a lot about, you know, your expertise and a little bit of, you know, your business, but you also mentioned that are you working, as it sounds like as an executive with a company as well?
Yes. I work for Open Exchange. I'm heading the customer success department there and I'm working with companies like Comcast or GoDaddy and so on. Right. So that's a very much bigger to scale than what I do in my private life. But the funny thing is, it all comes down to the same thing. It's the same spirit, right? It's offering value and creating things that matter instead of all the fluff that you sometimes have in marketing, right?
So how do you navigate the two? So you and is there an even amount of time spent on each project, we'll call it, as far as being an executive over here and being a business owner over here? How do those two worlds connect?
Well, at 9 to 6 usually belongs to my day job, right, which is being the executive. And then the other time is my hobby time. It's where I write the books. It's where I do the academy and so on. So that's the natural split, right? And then every now and then you move it about. In today's time, and that's the positive, right? When you don't have to work from an office or when you achieve a certain level, it's about the results. And when you achieve the results, nobody cares. It's the results have to be there, right?
100%. And it's the world that I'm in with wealth management. It's the years of experience and study that I've put into things and the effort that, you know, someone may ask me, you know, why does this cost this or whatever? It's, you know, if you've done this amount of time over here. And it's like, it's not the hour that it takes me or the 2 hours that it takes me, whatever the time is, it's the 10,000 hours that I took to get to this point, to be able to get the right information to you at the right time. When it comes to money, the right information at the right time means everything, because whether you lose money or you lose time, you're not going to get time back. So you got to make sure it's done right. And so you're saying the same exact thing as an expert. You can bring that skill level to where you're going to show them how to screw up less or not at all. And you're going to show them how to do it right, better, faster, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Because you've done it so many times, right? That it's right there. The funny thing is I had to train one of my colleagues, and they were on customer calls with me. And she was like, where do you pull all that information from? It's like, it's just experience. It's me doing marketing one way or the other since the mid-90s, right? It's just the feeling that you know that what the customer is saying is one thing, but what they really mean is the other thing, and just being able to provide them with different examples, right? And then guiding them along that and being okay with telling them no, but not a no and no, and that's all you say, but hey, maybe you want to go in this direction, right? And you want to take it a different approach. And that's the kind of consulting and guidance that they really look for. And that's necessary in a business, right?
Yeah, you mentioned two things I definitely want to explore on. So you talked about the academy and talked about books and being an author. Which one do you want to tackle first?
It really doesn't matter, because one comes from the other, right? I started both at the same time, and then eventually I had to focus and finish my book first. And I'm about ready to publish. I have to give it into final design and then do the academy, where I dive in deeper into the content of the book. Yeah.
Talk about the book. So as far as, is this your first book? And then the concept of the book, the meat, what's in the book, and the overall idea of it.
Yeah. So the concept of the book is what I mentioned at the beginning. I try to write it in such a way that it starts Monday morning, 9 a.m. and guides the user through. So after each chapter, there's guidance from me, and I have guidance for three different target audiences. I want to launch my product. I want to launch my company, and I'm changing my jobs, and I don't know what marketing really is about, right? So I go through a chapter, and then I have guidance for them. I have a workbook session where they can take notes, where I ask questions for them, where I point them to exercises that they could do. And so I guide them through the book. That's why the book's going to be pretty thick. I think it's like 400 pages, 450 pages.
Wow.
Because you have a workbook that's integrated in it, right? And so, yeah, that's a lot. And that's really what the book is about. Trying to get you there step by step. I'm not coming up with great concepts and theories and so on. There's a ton of other marketing books out there. But really what I try to do is get you every step of the way from A to Z, right?
Yeah. How long have you been writing the book?
I've kind of written two books along the way. I've written the first book and deleted it because it was all over the place. And then I've written this last one. And this one I essentially started in January 2019.
Yeah.
So the first book takes a long time because you have to get into the process of writing. You have to figure it out, right?
So I want to ask you, from one future author to the next, because I'm about, I'd say about 40% of the way, realistically. I was saying 60%, but I think I was lying. So I'm about 40% of the way done with my first book. And I know that there's different processes for writing the book. You know, some people want to do a page or two a day. Some people will block out time for a few hours. You know, there could be a whole list of things to do. But in terms of just making sure you're staying on it, and pumping out because there's so much you're doing in life, right? You have your personal life, you have your business life, you have your, you know, all the different things that you're doing. To write a book on top of that, that takes a lot of time. So what have you found that works for you, and like what doesn't work for you in terms of when you want to write the book?
For me, for the most time, what I did is I went to the library in New York, and I would be in the middle of all the students. I even had, in the wintertime, I would wear sweaters with these patches here, right? And being a total writer persona. But no, all kidding aside, I would go there every Friday, 9 to 6 p.m., and just write. My phone would be off. No emails, no nothing, just writing. And that's the only thing that I found that really works, is having a dedicated time. And before you get into that time zone, block everything off. Just focus. For me, music works. So I have a certain music. So there's a ritual, right? And eventually, at the beginning, it was really hard to get into that ritual and to find your groove, maybe. Yep. But then I switched on music, put the headphones on, and I was ready to go within 2 minutes. Right before, it took me 15 minutes, half an hour. But eventually, I got there within minutes, almost seconds. Sat down, headphones on, computer open, and go, right? And that's what ritual and a clear process does to you, right?
Same way with music. I do it when I'm doing kind of more mundane stuff in my business, like if I'm updating my CRM, or if I'm doing kind of stuff that's kind of data entry type stuff where like it's just easy to do. I'll put on something depending on my mood. But what kind of stuff are you listening to when you're writing the book?
Cinematic orchestra.
Okay. Yeah.
Movie works.
Yep.
Then there's Moby. He has some LA moods. It's, you couldn't listen to it if you're not working, but if you're working, because it's just spheric music, right? It's just, that works fantastic for me because there's nothing in the music that really disturbs or catches you emotionally. It's just in there. And then classical music, right? Mozart works for me.
I'm very similar when it comes to that. And then there's, for you, if you try this again, have you heard of the band Two Cellos before?
I did, yeah.
Two Cellos does a lot of remakes and retakes on, they're classical and they're great on, I guess they're violins, but they'll do like, even like Nirvana, like Teen Spirit, but like it'll be on the, like, so they'll, there's different moods, but it's all classical. Yeah. It's beautiful. So when do you expect the book to be ready?
Well, I hand it over to design either today or tomorrow. And then the indexer has to do his thing, I think, end of October.
Awesome. Yeah. And what do you see? I mean, obviously, it's a labor of love, but what kind of hopes do you have for the outcome of the book?
I actually don't have any hopes for it. What I want to use it, and the intention why I did it, is because I like the process of really digging into one topic and going really to the bottom of it. When people ask me about it, I usually say it's going to be a very, very big business card.
Exactly.
And from there on, if I can help people and if it helps a few people, that's fine, because I see it as a hobby. If eventually hobby becomes a real business, like with the academy, that would be fantastic. But for right now, I'm doing what I like, right? And it also helps me with my day job, because we're selling our product to the SMB market. So knowing the SMB on one hand and then selling product to the SMB on the other hand, it's all beneficial, both sides. So
I love what you say about the business card. I say the same thing about the podcast. I say it's the best business card I ever had. And, you know, obviously for you with the book, it's going to be utilitarian and it's going to be helping people, which is the main goal, but obviously it'll raise your street cred a little bit too.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, and you know, whether it's speaking engagements or more business, because you're really stepping into what you already are, which is a consultant, but you know, with having a book, you know, it really helps kind of push you a little bit. So congrats on that, brother. I'm happy for you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And so you said that potentially does bleed into the academy. Is the academy up and running? And if it is, tell us about it. And if not, what do you expect it to do?
Well, the academy itself is not really quite there yet, but what it's already there is a lot of blog posts, right? So I'm still in a process of building a foundation. We have a lot of content where people can get to know me before they buy from me, right? There's a free Twitter course where they can learn about Twitter and getting started with Twitter in general. But essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the entire book into an academy, into courses. So they can, if they like the book, there will be promotions in there, obviously, right? Where they can get a cheaper price of the academy and then really go through the courses and have hours by hours and hand and guidance in there. That's beyond what you can write in a book because it's 450 pages long already, right? And I had to delete at least at the same amount of them, right? So you have to stop it eventually.
Is this a hardcover or a soft cover?
It's going to be a soft cover. I'm going to do a couple of hardcovers and it's going to be an ebook as well. Without the workbook portion of it, you can still download it from the Academy pages for free, by the way. But yeah, it's going to be a soft cover for the most part. Yeah.
What's the price point on the soft cover?
I don't know yet. I have to see. It's going to be my printing price plus 10%. Again, you're not selling a lot of those books, right? So why go for a dollar extra in that? Overall, it gets to like $50 or $100 more, and or maybe $1,000. That's not going to change anything for you. But having a fair price also goes along with what I try to do, right? I try to help people. I'm not trying to squeeze every little buck from them, right? And then if that gets them to my website, and if that gets them to booking a consultancy from me and whatever, it's much more worth than anything else that I could have done with the book.
That's beautiful. I love that idea. Yeah, you're helping people and there's this thing called karma that's very real. And when you help enough people, you get helped. So it's beautiful. As far as, you know, people that you're into and plugged into, whether it's for, you know, hobbies, if you're into health and wellness, if you're into spirituality, but if it's business, who are the people that you seek out to learn from? And you know, whether they're people that are known or unknown, but do you have like thought leaders or people that you love their content or you love their message that you've really learned from and put it into your life?
Yeah, I'm not good with names, but I have one guy that he literally written the book on PSYOPs, right? So his entire approach, he trained the US PSYOPs department unit, right? And so I'm going to send him to you so that maybe you can key him in.
Beautiful. Yeah, we'll put it in the show notes. I'll have my editor put it in there. Yeah.
Yeah, at the bottom. So that he's one of the guys. And then for web design, I have a guy that the book is called Don't Make Me Think. Also a fantastic book. And I just like the headline itself, right? It's the don't make your customers think about what they have to do, right? It's just offer them and show them the path to get there. The headline is fantastic, right? It's an old book. It's about probably 10 years old, but it's still, the entire mindset is still great. And that's kind of the people that I go after, that I seek out and just stay on top. It could be anybody. I'm pretty active on Twitter. I try to interact with people and see what it is that they think about. And I meet a lot of people through my business, right? And through my day job. I ask them a lot of questions. I do a lot of research. So that's where I try to learn. I learn from everybody.
Yep.
It's the short answer.
that's a secret to success for me too, man. Definitely. It's just being curious and really being interested in how things work and relationships and learning about other people. I mean, that's part of why I do the podcast is because I'm learning the whole time you're speaking. And I want to ask questions that hopefully other people would be thinking of when they talk to someone like you so that they can figure out how to do some stuff as well. So in that vein, you know, what's the best piece of advice that you've ever gotten in your life that you use to this day?
Ask for help.
Beautiful.
It's the PSYOP mantra, right? It's the go ahead and ask people for help. People are more nicer than you think, right? More helpful than you think. And you never know what they come back with. And it changes the entire dynamic of a conversation.
Beautiful, beautiful. Well, what's the rest of 2020 look like for you? You got anything, you're just kind of getting settled back in Germany? Like what do you got planned for the rest of 2020? Or what are you looking forward to into 2021?
Well, first of all, I've got two other books in the making right now. One is a book about my childhood and growing up being black in Germany, right? And what I've learned and seen in the US and how I had to fight my way through coming from that area and, you know, tips and tricks and how that education is important, that being nice to people is important and people are different and being okay with people being different and, you know, learning from that. And then the other book is more like a travel book. I did a trip and I threw it in Route 66 and a lot of what my Manhattan. So I kind of create a picture book about my New York. My New York, I call it B-sides, right? the Academy, and I'm probably going to have 5 other ideas by the end of the week.
Beautiful. That's awesome, brother.
Just doing it.
Well, we'll definitely put all the links to everywhere that you could be found anywhere. So hopefully we can make sure that we connect you with people and that you can keep helping people the way that you have been and keep shining that light, brother. But thank you so much. And he's the amazing, the mighty, the powerful Maurice Hoffman. I'm Jesse T. Be sure to catch us on next week's episode of The Jesse T Show.
Thank you so much. Be good. Okay.